Ladies and gentlemen, welcome and congratulations on choosing this session, which will be far, far better than all the others, and also different from anything that you've experienced before, at least during this conference, if not in your life. My name's John Nagg, and I'm a global citizen, and an innocent in the field of English as a medium of instruction, which people have told me is a controversial subject in India, Africa, South Asia, Denmark, and the rest of Northern Europe, and Southern Europe, and Northeast Asia, and perhaps some other places. This session will be different from all the other sessions in the conference. It won't be a paper and questions, but it is, will be a debate. It's a competition. This is not about finding the truth. This is about winning. My four panelists are all distinguished educationalists and academics who've been asked to put their balanced attitude towards evidence to one side a little bit and to concentrate on one side of the argument. The topic is EMI does not bring the benefits that people expect, and we have two sides. For that motion, we have Baela Jamil from Pakistan, Hywel Coleman from Indonesia. Speaking against the motion, we have Lizzi Milligan from the UK and Nigussie, Negash, Yadete from Ethiopia. The rules, as I hope I've indicated, the idea is for this to be to some extent light-hearted, but with obviously serious undertones that the subject deserves. The rules are each first speaker will have 7 minutes each to present their case. I'll then ask you in the audience to give your own opinion very, very, very short, few seconds, please. I want some audience participation, so think what you're going to say, please. Another rule is no interruptions while they're speaking, but you can clap or cheer or hiss if you want. The times will be strict. I'll tell speakers when there's a minute left, and the alarm, a loud alarm, will go off after 7 minutes, which I won't stop. Anyone who finishes in advance will be congratulated. At the end, there'll be a vote. And the most important rule of all is that at the end of the hour, we'll all remain friends. Okay? With that said, English medium of instruction does not bring the benefits that people expect. By Ella Jamil.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been a very exciting 1.5 day for me. And I have been inspired tremendously. And if I have to debate for this motion today, I would like to be provocative and inspiring at the same time and suggest you put on your cartographer's hats for the moment and think about maps of the world in which we can superimpose those maps with language. And if you look at the first set of maps as clusters of economic productivity and growth, where do you see the greatest amount of economic growth? And where you see those, and if you were to populate those maps, you would see that East Asia and Asia comes out as a clear winner. That winning streak was not possible if there was English as a medium of instruction. That could have only been possible in the language of those countries. Today, if it is, we have the Pacific century looming over us, if we have East Asia with showing what it has been able to do in delving in economic growth through scientific investigation, research, and development, well, that has clearly been in the language that they know best, the language of their soil, where they've spent time and monies in developing those languages coming up with ways and means of becoming competitive and having the edge, not just of emotions, but also of production and vying for the markets of the world. And that's how we are measuring the success of language. So if you can think in terms of that cluster of maps, hold that on. I'd like you to also think in terms of another cluster of maps. And this time, I'd like to take you in something that I feel extremely passionate about, and I'm sure you do too. And that those are the cultural maps of the world. And if you look at, again, this region, and I would like to talk about Asia, but perhaps even the globe, the most amount of aesthetic delight that we, whether we receive from music, or we receive from the arts, fine arts, or we receive from textiles, etc., those come really, again, as they are thought through the entire spectrum of expression and histories and cultural legacies that come not from a foreign language, but not from an English as a medium of instruction, but again of mother tongues and the multilingual tapestries that become the warp and the weft in which we are so used to in this region, the Tana and the Bana, of language and emotion that produces that kind of richness that we are so used to. That couldn't have been possible, and I always love and I've cherished supporting the arts and the crafts and textiles and music by saying that there is no concept of developed and the underdeveloped and the developing. There is only one concept. And the only way that could have happened was if people had stuck to how they were thinking indigenously and most natively and what they could produce with the finest of the minds. And just over lunch, we were discussing whether, in fact, ideas, if there was no language, then you needed a language. But did you need an oral language or a written language and so on and so forth? So that's the second cluster of maps that I'd like you to hold on to. The third one, this morning, we were very inspired, is of technologies. 3 minutes. So technologies today are showing what you can do with multiple languages. Today, your thoughts are what are most important. Whatever language that you're thinking in, what you have to give to the world through technology and Google translations, the languages are multiplying. So there is no compromise that you have to have English as a medium of instruction through which prism you have to pass your original thinking. But in fact, you can hold on to your original thinking, do all the development in the world that you want to, and just put your thought out as an original thought, critical, creative, and go on with it. So shifting to the last two pieces, or three last pieces that I want to do and very quickly is, never, never think about compromising the whole notion of critical thinking, which is a much higher ordered form than, you know, coming on top of the IELTS test. Is it, what, 7 or 8 or whatever? But you need to be a critical thinker. You think, you assess, you change, you come up with new ideas. And that's the higher ordered story of human species. In Islam, we say, anul haqq, that's a Sufi thought, that you are made in my image. You are God. I am God because I am a critical thinker, because I'm creative. I'm not derivative. Derivative thinking is just following some master's speech. Derivative thinking does not produce successful people. Derivative thinking, if it's only through the English medium of instruction, simply because that's what is happening in the rest of the world and you have to follow that, and especially people from this part who've been colonized, derivative thinking has been the bane of these societies, and we need to be able to think things further. And lastly, I would like to say, let us, in derivative thinking, we must remember from this soil that Macaulay's minute has been our ghost, and we need to purge that ghost. 17 years of thinking of where to spend that 100,000 rupees led to the 1835 minute, and that minute swept aside the centuries and the tradition of amazing thinking of this world. Well, that is all coming back today, but let us not be haunted by Macaulay's spectre. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Baela Jamil, for finishing within your 7 minutes. And I'm going to pass now the word to Lizzi Milligan to oppose the motion.
So I'm going to start by saying that I do recognise that English medium instruction is one of the things that can significantly limit educational achievement. But we know that there are some contexts, and there's evidence that in those contexts it can work. International schools across the world, for example, immersion school contexts in North America, in CLIL in Spain. But we also know that these are high-performing learners, and they're usually from very high socioeconomic status. And what we learn from those contexts is the importance of a dedicated pedagogy, and also the accompanying structure of initial teacher education, publishing, and assessment. In sub-Saharan Africa, in the context where I've worked, rarely, if at all, do we find that accompanying structure. Teachers are not trained as English as a second language teachers, and they themselves often have poor English. Textbooks can assume much higher levels of English proficiency than the children have. And assessment is too often a test of language than of content knowledge. But I would argue that this is not just an EMI issue, and we should be wary of thinking that EMI is the main or one of those main problems. We know, with huge amounts of evidence, that there are millions and millions of children who are leaving school without a basic education, without basic literacy and numeracy skills. And many of these are skills which they should have been learning when in early primary and learning through mother tongue. And we are now in a situation where we are calling it a learning crisis. We're calling for a quality imperative. And there's a real focus on the fact that quality of education is failing in many, many countries. Teachers are often untrained or not trained in the right way. They're often expected to use learner-centered pedagogy, but that's not compatible with curriculum demands. And those curricula are very often over-ambitious and overloaded. In my own work in Kenya, in Kenyan secondary education, I found that there were children who were sleeping as little as 4 hours a night because they were in school for 14 hours a day, and then when they get home, they are working for 4 hours before going to sleep. This is a hugely overloaded curriculum, and the fact that it's in English, I don't think, is the main problem. Materials are often not supportive of teaching and learning. They're very difficult to read, and they're also often not contextually relevant. Alongside that, you have schools that are not safe, they're overcrowded, there's poor sanitary. The list could go on. Are these EMI issues? Yes, to a certain extent they are, but they're also wider quality issues. And more than that, they're social justice issues, because it's the disadvantaged who are the most affected. I would also argue that we need to be aware of the policy reality. English, and often English medium instruction, is seen as the answer to multiple questions. And just in Rwanda, we can see that when they made the decision to change to English medium instruction, that was related to wanting to be, yes, part of a global economy, but it also had reasons to do with national unity, post-genocide, etc. So we need to be realistic and understanding of the different reasons why governments are choosing to use English medium instruction. So I believe that we need to find a way to make it work and to make it work for all children. We can push and we can advocate for change into different mediums of instruction, but if we keep it as it is, I personally, the way I would like to work is recognizing that we need to work within that structure. So we need to be looking at effective and appropriate teacher training, curricula that's relevant and allows space in the classroom for checking of understanding, and policies that enable teachers and are not restricting them. And with that, I would argue that using their first language is something that needs to be part of English medium instruction. And alongside that, materials that support language development. I talked yesterday about some of the work we've been doing in Rwanda around that. So we need to be recognizing the ways to improve the use of English medium instruction. And if these are addressed, maybe English medium instruction can have the benefits that policymakers, parents, and learners hope that it will.
Thank you very much, Lizzi, and congratulations to you as well. You've finished on time. And now is the time when we have before our second speakers on each side, we'll have something from the audience. Do we have microphones to go around the audience? Oh, yeah, good. Can we have some short contributions and our speakers who are speaking second and summing up will be listening and attempting to come back in their next parts, next presentations on with some answers for you. Yeah. If you're under those lights, it's very difficult to see. It's very glary, but I can just see someone here.
Yeah. Hello.
Go ahead.
I wish I could speak Urdu here, or my own language. I think the lady against the motion talked about appropriate curricula in English for all children in the world. I wonder how that be possible, because in the world there is no homogeneous culture. There are so many cultures. If, for instance, my child, Torwali child in extreme north in Pakistan, if he is forced to learn rowing or inside skating in the curricula in the textbooks, how it could be possible to him to go with that?
Okay, thank you very much. Good. Another short, under 30-second contribution over here, Chris Brandwood.
I'll resist the debate. I think there's the muddle between education and English medium instruction. I think there are excellent examples all around the world of bad teaching and bad education, whether it's kids not learning languages in schools in the UK. If it's anywhere you go, you can find education systems, whether it's in the West, Middle East, South Asia, East Asia, that are not working well. If things are not working well, it's quite difficult to then impose a language system which is different, and then to blame the language system for the other ills. One first has to separate the language aspects and the educational aspects.
Chris, well,
I would tend to agree with this team on
that's
right.
That's exactly what I was going
that,
to ask.
That is the key thing. I think there's a rights and responsibilities issue, which is children have the right to choose a good education, and educators have responsibility to give a good education, be it multilingual, monolingual, whichever.
Okay, thank you. Professor Mahanti here.
If it is a question of quality, of improving English medium schooling and then bringing about changes, why can't the same thing be done for mother tongue medium schools, you know, improving the quality and everything else, and make it even better?
Good point.
One has to, you know, talk about that.
We'll certainly expect an answer to that one, won't we?
language and a way of thinking, our thought process are tied together. Because a mother tongue is either the language of your father, mother, or of both that you acquire naturally since childhood. And with that mother tongue, you develop a way of thinking. And if you're taught in a foreign language, then you tend to acquire foreign way of thinking. Thank you.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing to have a foreign way of thinking? Oh, right. Oh, yes, right. Okay, it's a good question. Over here on this table.
Yes, I'd like to shift the focus a little bit away from classroom outcomes and scholars. Not scholar, that's in French. Scolaire. You know, schooling outcomes. And go towards what happens to the products of English medium instruction. So do they, when I saw the title of the panel today, I thought you'd be also talking about what happens to the graduates or the products of this system, do they get what they want? To begin with, if they were willing to pay such a high premium for English medium education, do they really get what they expected in the long run, which is a socioeconomic improvement?
What do the parents do it for?
Has there been any research on this? I actually doubt that because I haven't seen any. Thank you.
Yeah. Do they want to get this very instrumental outcome that they're looking for? Yeah. Okay.
Just a quick question. Can colonized nations such as ours afford to isolate ourselves from the English language and the developed world and that entire sort of gamut of development that it actually entails?
Okay, that seems to be a natural break. But we do have there's one more here. There's someone, this lady is desperate to say something, so I'm going to be very generous, and then we'll go on. But after this, there'll be another opportunity after the next intervention from the stage for the audience to have another go. So start to think.
It's related to this question. So I would like to ask, like, if you take China, Japan, Germany, France, those who are teaching their children in their language, are they more integrated into world economy and culture? Or are we more integrated into?
Okay, thank you very much. Hywel Coleman, you have 7 minutes to not only answer all these questions, but to say what you were going to say in the first place. Is that okay?
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the opportunity. I almost don't need to respond to the opponents because they've admitted from the beginning that they have an extremely weak case. So there is nothing that I need to oppose in their case. Let me take you, just to illustrate in real classroom terms, let me take you to 5 classrooms in different parts of the world, and we'll see the reality. What happens when English is being used as the medium of instruction because parents or head teachers or governments think that it's a useful idea? First, I'll take you to a private primary school in a suburb of Jakarta. Year 2 primary, English is being used as the medium of instruction. The teacher is teaching mathematics. The teacher is Indonesian. And the little children are not allowed to speak their mother tongue or the national language. What they have to do is go around the class and ask each other, which one do you like? Pizza, noodle, chicken, fried rice. And then they make a record. They tick what their friends tell them. Then together, they build up a diagram, a table, showing how many children like chicken, how many like noodles, and so on. The only language that the children have used in this process is, which one do you like best? Pizza, noodle, chicken, fried rice. Again and again and again. There is no other conversation among the children. The teacher comments at the end, turns out that noodles are the most popular food, and the teacher says, noodle has a big fans, oh my God. And then the children have to fill in a gap in a written sentence. And the sentence is, there are, blank, pupils like fried rice. And they have to write in the number. So what we see here is a situation in which the teacher is not in complete control of English. The children have no freedom to explore the language, to use the language in their own way. The children can't ask the teacher questions. They can't play with the language. They're simply repeating a single sentence. And at the end of this, they're somehow supposed to have acquired some mathematics. The children are not learning mathematics. They're not acquiring mathematical concepts. They're not really acquiring much English. But they have a nice time. They move around and they talk to each other. Okay, now let me take you to Korea. And a year 11 class in Korea, secondary school. A very state school, but high profile, given a lot of additional funding, because they're using English as the medium of instruction. The class are all girls, the teacher is female, and they're studying chemistry through English. The teacher begins the lesson using English, and she is talking about something called stoichiometry, which I'd never heard of before. And apparently stoichiometry is the determination of equivalent weights of substances in chemical reactions. The girls don't know what she's talking about. And you can see, the observer could see that the pupils didn't know what was happening. The teacher also sensed that the pupils didn't know what was happening. And then eventually, because she was getting no reaction, no feedback at all from the children, eventually one of the girls nervously put her hand up and asked the teacher, "What is stoichiometry?" And the teacher translated it into Korean, and all the girls said, "Oh." And then the teacher gradually shifted into using Korean, and everything went smoothly thereafter. This illustrates what an obstacle using English as the medium of instruction is creating for learning, and how much more comfortable the children are, the learners are, how much more relaxed the teacher can be, how much more fluent the interaction will be if the learners can use their own language. So the expectation is that by teaching chemistry through English, in some way the children are going to improve their competences is absolute nonsense. Let me take you now to Morocco, a primary school in Morocco. The children are Berber children, and their first language is Tashalhit, which is a Berber language. And the teacher tells me, "Sometimes we explain things to the pupils in Tashalhit, even when we're supposed to be teaching in Arabic. But you can see a sparkle in the children's eyes when you use Tashalhit." So again, we can see that in this case, the official language is not English, it's Arabic, but it's the same issue, the same problem. Use a language that the children don't understand, and they don't sparkle. Use the children's first language, they sparkle. They know what's happening, they can understand. Now, let me take you back to Korea. No, not Korea. Korea, sorry. Year 5 primary. A rather wise primary school teacher. He has to teach all subjects to his children, including mathematics, and he's supposed to use English in teaching mathematics from time to time. But he recognizes that this is nonsense. And he tells me, "It's impossible to teach new concepts in English. The language level of the students is lower than their conceptual level, so they can't express themselves in English. Therefore, in the mathematics through English lessons, I do a lot of childish activities." So he can see that the conceptual level of the children is much higher than the English language level of the children. Why create an extra problem for the children in making them do their mathematics through English? The case is clear.
Congratulations, Hywel. I did rather like that part where it all ended happily ever after when they started to use Korean as sort of showed the power of the storytelling. I kind of enjoyed that. Nigussie. Yes. You have your 7 minutes against the motion.
Thank you. I'm coming from a country that adopted English as a medium of instruction in the 1940s. Ethiopia was not colonized. Actually, that country is a symbol of freedom for Africa because it fought Italy, and Italy occupied occupied Ethiopia for 5 years. But we still chose English as a medium of instruction. There is a reason for that. These countries, we need to give them the benefit of doubt that they think what's good for them, and they want access to the rest of the world. Between now and 1940s, there has been a lot of change. There is more and more economic integration, globalization, so the need for English, the need for one language is unquestionable. If it's not English, it's another language, to be honest. Okay. Having said that, I would like to address some points raised by our opponents. I would like to thank the audience for supporting the motion against medium instruction, English medium of instruction. From our opponent's side, I just want to come out of sitting safe on the fence and be controversial again. Just take my hat off as an academic. I wish some points were raised about where do we see economic growth? Asia, right. It's true, Asian countries have been seen in Africa as models of economic development. But these countries send their products to Africa and other places. And the instrument for them to do that is English. Okay, when it reaches Africa, it doesn't reach in Japanese or in Chinese, it changes. So we buy the products because there is English as a medium. The cultural issues raised, the arts and etc. There is a lot of creativity in cultural arts. Of course, culture is very indigenous to a particular setting. But art is its own language. But when you want to sell the art you have produced, you need English to the rest of the world, don't you? Technology, of course, there is a lot of change, a lot of innovation. Technology is using these in local languages, indigenous languages, but the dominant publications we have now, the resources we have now are in English. If you say we have to stop using English, then you are denying your citizens the right to access these resources. Are you not prescribing to them? Are you not dictating what your citizens should freely choose? Critical thinking was raised again. This is not specific to a language as far as I'm concerned. Critical thinking is a methodology. You can develop critical thinking in any language, okay? Just because you adopt English as a medium of instruction, it doesn't mean you stop thinking critically. I have question about, in my own country, the new policy as of 1991, we have adopted mother tongue as a medium of instruction from grade 1 to grade 4 or 5, even to second cycle. But I have concern whether the children develop critical thinking because that policy was adopted. Critical thinking is about the methodology or the curriculum and the teacher training. Okay, these inputs should be there for you to achieve critical thinking. In universities, we teach basic academic skills, for example, as remedial courses, English for academic purposes. It's amazing what we spend our time on. We teach them to describe something in one paragraph in a university level because they don't have that skill when they come to the university. This should have been done in the mother tongue, and it's easy to transfer academic skills to any language, I guess. Well, that should be proven by research anyway, but that's my position. Somebody from the audience, a gentleman from the audience raised, I wish I could speak Urdu, he said, I guess. And he raised the issue of curriculum and content not being homogeneous, the cultural contents. I think this is not, this has long been debated by people like Kanagaraja, all right, in relation to resistance to English language teaching. That his seminal work was not, I don't think it was against the language. His seminal work showed that students in the classroom resisted the content in the curriculum. What I want to say is the cultural contents can be adopted. I mean, we can teach English native speakers culture using English, but still we can choose our own contents, culturally appropriate contents, even teaching English. So if things are not working well, we can't blame that only on using English as a medium of instruction. I need to say this. I think the L1 medium of instruction has its own place, and English language as a medium of instruction should have its own place. Thank you.
Thank you, Nigussie, and congratulations to you too. I'm very disappointed I haven't been able to use the alarm on my iPhone, having spent a long time selecting the loudest sound that I could find. There's still a chance. There's still a chance. Was it 3 or 4 years ago that the British Council published a book called Dreams and Realities? Was that the full title, Hywel? Dreams and Realities, Developing Countries and the English Language, edited by Hywel Coleman, with a chapter by Nigussie, Negash, Yadete. Nigussie's chapter featured in more than one of the reviews that was in that book. It was a very controversial chapter, so we're very happy about that. And this book is available, like all the British Council publications, online on our Teaching English website. If you just Google Dreams and Realities British Council or Dreams and Realities Hywel Coleman, you'll find it, so please feel free to have a look. And not only to have a look, but if you're a university academic, to feel free to use that material with your students, with your researchers on the course, and that's what all our publications are for. And I think that particular publication is still very useful, and it has a really global view of this issue. Okay, I'm going to pass back to the audience for some more comments or even complaints that your panelists didn't answer the questions that you asked in the first place, if you want, because they're going to go back again. So they're going to have another summing up at the end. I've got a few minutes for the audience. Yes, sir.
I think the debate is about EOI, English as EOI. While I think English is the language of a wider communication, indeed we in this hall all speak English to each other. That's good as globally and global economics is done in English. But when we impose it as EOI at schools, where different cultures exist, so it creates problems for the kids to learn. English could be a subject introduced in these schools, but it could not be as medium of instruction, shouldn't be there in any culture in any in the world.
Okay, thank you. See Professor Mahanti, then I'll come over here.
Study after study, it is shown quite emphatically that mother tongue medium education is better. And from the data, the kind of thing that Hywel has presented, not only mother tongue education is better, it is inevitable in a class, regardless of the medium of instruction. You know, even if you are using English medium, you still have to go back to the mother tongue to get across the concepts. And then the question of access, what is important? Is access important to trigger brain drain from a country, or is it important to provide quality education to your children? You know, and then the question of diversity, what is English doing to diversity? That also, I think, some of the panelists should have addressed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And, okay, the lady next to you.
I think whether it's English or any other language, if a language is imposed on children, I think that has to be registered. Okay. If that's the case with English, it should be registered. 1 second. As much as I understand development of critical thinking, I think, you know, it's not only the method, it's also about accepting oneself. If I'm accepted, I accept myself, my language is included, I can historically engage with myself and my society, I then, over a period of time, can develop critical thinking. It's not about you ask me a critical question and I give you a critical answer. It's not that. Critical thinking is very different, and we still could not shed off our colonial inferiority complex because we did not engage with ourselves historically. I think critical thinking, if you want critical thinking to be promoted, mother tongue has to be. And also if mother tongue, a mother tongue, is imposed, that's also, you know, discriminatory. We're talking about multilingual societies where a lot of languages are spoken. So we cannot decide even from among the local languages to prioritize few over others.
So imposing the mother tongue can be as discriminatory as imposing a colonial language.
Yeah. Can I just say one more thing? Do I have time?
Okay, 10 seconds.
Okay. You know, in this country, I studied in a multilingual classroom, which was designed in Jim Cummings' line. I was taught in Odia medium, you know, for 10, 11 years, and I was taught Hindi in class 5 and 6, then I was taught English from class 4 onwards, and English becomes my medium of instruction, became my medium of instruction in university education, okay. But it was discriminatory to thousands of people who did not speak Odia, but lived in Odisha, and were forced to accept Odia as their mother tongue. I think, you know, this country should first talk about its own context, you know. We have been trying out one model of multilingual education, which has also discriminated thousands of children, many hundred communities.
Okay, thank you. It was more than 10 seconds, but it was so interesting that I just couldn't stop you. And then after Chris, that gentleman had a question. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, right. Hello.
I think Korean stoichiometry was very interesting. And that school, it would be very interesting to have a study of the school if the children, at the end of their academic career, came out with an excellent level of Korean, an excellent level of English, and had a mixed input academic career and had some additional wealth because of that, then I think that would be a good thing. I can just imagine that on the day, stoichiometry would leave somebody cold. It would leave any of us cold, probably even here. But I think one needs to see the whole thing. Is it working for a whole system? And there, that was a system where there was a choice and good pedagogy, I imagine, in the long run, one would hope. And therefore, you've got two things working. Somebody has a choice and good practice. Imposition and bad practice maybe is a bad thing, but choice and good practice can only be enriching. That's my opinion.
Okay, fine. Sir, did you have something to say? Can we have some female voices? Ah, good.
Yeah. I would like to say three things from three different perspectives on the same issue. One is the political. Any language which a country adopts or probably tries to decide to be one of the main medium of instruction is more of a political issue. For example, take China. From school till college till university, everything is in Chinese. Even anybody from India who goes to China to study postgrad or graduate, they are expected to learn Chinese, and the medium of instruction becomes Chinese. In India, has a political history of taking English as the main medium of instruction. Second, the perspective is economy. For example, if a child undertakes entire schooling in Hindi, but when it comes to job, the main important vocational skill is at least able to speak functional English. So that becomes a barrier. Okay. Hence, in a way, English as a means of instruction does benefit children. Third, the last thing which I would like to say is also the social aspect. For example, I was in a school in which Hindi was taught till 5 as a medium of instruction. There was a sudden shift in grade 5 from grade 5 onwards. I was not able to pick it up. There was social stigma. Teacher used to give preference to those kids who used to learn English. They're from a well-off family. There was a lot of discrimination that impacted my learning in English.
Yeah. Okay, it's interesting to know.
The last educational...
You just did the last one.
The third one was the last one. This is the fourth perspective.
The fourth one's the last one. Okay.
The educational perspective is, I think, what the both for and against. Probably, I think against the people in the against did address it in terms of curriculum. But I would say the problem is not with English as being the medium of instruction, but the way they teach English, the way teachers teach English. It can be made understandable to children from grade 1 to 10.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. The lady in the red. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm Tania from Bangladesh. I didn't think English should come as a subject, as one of the one member from the audience have said about it, because English is a language. If the student get English as just a subject, they will the exercise they are the teachers are teaching English. Right at this moment, the exercise will carry on. So if we just think about how we learn about our mother language, how we learn it, our mothers make us to say, we listen to our mothers, and she didn't stop us whenever we make mistake. She wanted to listen to us. And in this way, we learn about our mother language. And English can be also taught in this way. And I'm not saying that I'm in opposition of using mother tongue-based language, but I am I'm saying that mother tongue will be usable whenever the teacher and the student don't understand.
So you're in favor of a balanced approach.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Right. Okay. Let's leave it there, and let's go now to the summing up, in which the two teams have 4 minutes each to finally convince you of the righteousness of their argument.
So, well, obviously there has been a tremendous resonance to what we have been arguing as a team, that it is important to celebrate diversity. It is important to address the issue of how the business of education takes place as a higher ordered business, where critical thinking is not only about assessment and analysis, but also upgrading thought processes, where you can rely on history, on geography, on contexts, to be able to take your current issues and the way you're engaging with knowledge and be as a crafter of your own knowledge. That takes best, as Professor Mohanty also said, in your own language. And I think we are completely with the motion that no language really ought to be imposed. And even where pragmatic decisions have to be taken, well, they then need to have a blended approach when it comes to language and a balanced approach. The issue of how do you purge yourself of your colonized past, well, the worst way to do is to adopt English as a medium of instruction simply to think that you are purging, because you are not purging. All you are doing is you're going more deeply colonized, because you're constantly trying to think that you are going to please someone by dumbing down what are your original thought processes in the language that you feel and think, but in another language where you're trying to please someone who's distant. Today, as I've said, in technology, the way technology is, you can do instant translations. And where my colleague said that, look, even though China or East Asia or Japan, they may be sending products, but the instructions are in English, well, that's always for a segmented market. It doesn't matter. It depends. Anyone who's do clever economics and markets has to ensure who the target audience is, and they do what they must do. We were not saying, I hope both of us were not for a minute saying that let's purge English altogether. What we were saying is English as a medium of instruction really hasn't proved much. All it does is, of the 250 million children who have been in school and not learning, there's a large chunk of those who have been under the English medium of instruction schools. If we disaggregated that, we'd realize that too caused many children not to learn other than a pedagogical method which did not teach them right in the first place. And we are in the business of assessment, and we know that if learning has to be at the center of it all, then the language issue is a very important one. And certainly not an imposed language will never help children to learn. So I think all in all, what we are trying to, we have been suggesting, and what many friends from the floor also suggested, that in the language in which the child feels, the language in which the mother speaks, the language in which real creativity progresses and prospers has to be the language where the child is given opportunity to grow, develop, and evolve, and not in imposed languages and imposed dumbed-down constructs. Thank you.
Thank you. Having listened to the various attempts to oppose the motion, I can just about see a couple of arguments there. But I worry that maybe the opponents haven't clearly distinguished between English as a medium of instruction and teaching English. Okay, English as a subject. And they're arguing English is important in the world, therefore, apparently, we need English as a medium of instruction. Even the importance of the need for English is sometimes exaggerated. In Gabon, the government wants to introduce English in primary schools because it's needed for children to work. I asked employers, what do your employees need? Do they need English? They said, no, they don't need English. They need a good basic secondary education and some French. So the perception in that context that English would solve problems and help children find work was misguided. The second argument that I've heard is that English should not be blamed for all the ills of poor education systems. Sure, there are many other factors, but because there are many other factors, why add another one on top of those poor aspects of the education system and create yet another burden? The case against is dismissed.
And your summing up on this team, please.
So I'd just like to start by coming back to that blaming language for all ills. And some of those examples that you used, Hywel, I would say that you could take a critical lens and say that there's much more going on than just language. In the first example, there's a content issue of what they're learning, the fact that it's not actually maths, that they're walking around and there's not a clear structure for what's going on in that classroom. So I think in all of these examples, we can go beyond EMI and see that there are other issues going on. There was a really good point that was made about, do graduates get what they want? And I think you're right that there isn't enough research for us to really know what graduates think when they have left EMI education. But what we do know in many contexts is that there's still this perceived benefit of having English from the point of view of parents, policymakers, and the learners. And while there's still that perceived benefit, if we were to move away from English medium instruction in many contexts, what I believe would happen is that we would get more and more private, low-cost private education through English medium instruction, and we would that could lead to a more stratified society.
Thank you. I think we're focusing on one, just one piece of the puzzle when we talk about language, don't we? Because we're increasingly becoming multilingual, and because of globalization, we're getting interconnected and interdependent. That involves issues beyond language. Issues about politics, issues about economy. These countries need to share resources, trade with each other. So they need a language to access or to interact. Then they also need their citizens to be proficient, to be able to use at least one language from the international languages, whatever. If we say, yes, it's true, I mean, learning one own language helps to develop culture, it's true. But if we stick to each other's language, how are we going to communicate? We cannot stop the force of change. And we have to be multilingual. And then one of those languages should be English or whatever language is accessible to us now. A gentleman from the audience raised access to English language as a medium of instruction has led to brain drain. I think there are factors beyond English that force people to leave their countries. There are issues of freedom, human rights, many things. Right. The need for English is exaggerated. I think with the current state of the world, I think English is very critical, and we have to learn it properly, and that can be done through proper teacher training and curriculum development. We need to mobilize resources to make it better. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Congratulations again. We're nearly there. So, to sum up, and before our half an hour coffee break, before the next parallel session, we come to the vote about, perhaps not about the subject itself, but about which team has... So, we'll do it on I, yeah? We're all talking about, is it EMI, English as a medium of instruction, or is it EMO, English as a medium of obstruction? For those who would like to vote for this team, say aye.
Aye.
For those who would like to say vote for this team, say aye.
Aye.
There's nothing else for me to say except... Can you please join me in giving a huge thanks to our panelists for being such good sports? Thank you very much.